Morning, everyone. Sorry for the technical details. I'm not a very technical guy, so I have to deal with something which is not very familiar with me. Thank you, first of all. Thank you for having invited me. Unfortunately, I don't speak Greek at all. I only know a few words. Kalimera is one of them. But I just to show you that I've been here before. You can see a picture that I actually they were building the Parthenon when I came at that time, and the lady is still my wife, so I'm happy to show you this picture. And as I've told you before, I'm not a developer, and this is okay. And the second one I've invented it. I'm an old marketing guy, and you should never trust an old marketing guy like me. So whatever I say, you should take it with a due doubt. I hope you all know LibreOffice. LibreOffice is an office productivity suite, a free office productivity suite. It was born out of the OpenOffice community. It was born for a reason. The founders, which are a group of around 30 people, that at the time were among the leaders of the OpenOffice community in different areas, thought that with the Oracle acquisition, the future of OpenOffice was at risk. So we discussed and we decided that it was time for the community to take the responsibility of the evolution of the product, that actually was and still is a very good product, although you know that there are no news since 1 month when Oracle announced that OpenOffice would become a community-based project, but that was a very difficult to understand announcement. So what we think that we did the right move, because we still think and we still are convinced that corporate sponsored products with a dual licensing business model like OpenOffice, so you have basically a free software and a proprietary one we sold with a license. This model we don't think is going to work. It has never really worked, and it is not going to work at all. Companies that are using the dual licensing with an added value version, that is a completely different business model. They usually sell added value and services. So when you buy the license, in reality, you don't buy the license of the software. You buy the added value, which is on services. While when you are on the desktop, the added value is a lot more difficult to distinguish. And this is the reason why I would say 99% of people are using the free software, and 1% is using the proprietary version. This doesn't make the business model as working, because the company is not earning any money. We have a completely different vision about our business, the business model, because it's not our business model. We would like to make it a reality, is that the Document Foundation will create an ecosystem around LibreOffice. The ecosystem will be formed by many diverse companies. We have already some: Novell, Red Hat, Canonical, but it's open to IBM, it's open to many other companies, and to Oracle as well. But it's also open to a lot of small companies, and especially in Europe, you have many small companies that do consultancy on software, and to individual that sell consultancy services. So why we shouldn't see a business model where people is recognized by the Document Foundation and is certified for their skills, and they, in this way, they can sell the services to the market. Of course, it's not something that you can describe in a very short time, but I'm happy to discuss with you later today. So LibreOffice, we use Libre because we think that free is our basic reason. Of course, that is different. I'm sure that you don't know how the houses of Microsoft people are done, but this is the house of Microsoft people. They have to change at least one window. I haven't seen any Windows 7 house so far, but this was the previous one. A little bit of background on what has happened. You know, OpenOffice is a 10-year-old project, now all close to 11. It was started in year 2000 when Sun donated the code to the community. And it was a project that started very slowly, because I can tell you that building a community and building the project is very complicated and very difficult. But anyway, I would say that from 2006 on, the growth was really amazing. And OpenOffice got to 2010 with a market share overall worldwide around 15%, and in some European countries over 20%. The problem is that at the same time the community grew up, and growing up the community wanted to have a stronger say in the evolution of the project and the evolution of the product. And this was not happening because the single sponsor manages the software like it is a proprietary software. It is a free software on the market, but it is a proprietary software in the development area. So the developers who are paid make all the decisions about the features, about the bugs that have to be solved, about the patches that have to be committed into the software. And this was probably acceptable during the first years of the community, but was not anymore acceptable after 10 years. The community was mature. There were people with a background in business, like myself, but others as well, that were into the community. And of course, it's completely different if you have only a bunch of hackers and developers, or you start to have people that has been a manager in a large corporation. Many years ago, I've been an executive vice president of Honeywell. I've worked in other U.S. corporations, but in the group of the founders, there is a former vice president of Oracle and a former vice president of IBM. So you understand that we can talk at any level with companies as well, and this has made increasingly difficult for the single sponsor to keep control of the community. So after 10 years, we decided that it was really time to become independent. Of course, our vision was to change the direction of the OpenOffice community, so we invited everyone to get into the Document Foundation, but for reason that I would not like to discuss, Oracle decided not to enter into the foundation, and some other people as well, they decided not to do that. So what happened is that probably 90% of the OpenOffice community switched because of the same reasons. They were feeling that the umbrella structure, I like very much this slide because gives exactly an idea of what has happened. So You see on your left the umbrella structure. The umbrella structure is exactly what was for 10 years under Sun and Oracle. You have an umbrella. The umbrella protects you from many things, protects you from water, but in some cases it's also an excuse for not doing things, because if you get out of the umbrella, you are at a risk. So what we have done is exactly what you see in the picture. So we have reversed the umbrella and made it a ball. And I like very much to think that this ball is like a canoe where everyone has to row in the same direction. And if you don't, if people in one side they row and the other don't row, the canoe goes round. And if people do not agree on the direction that they row, the canoe goes nowhere. So we try to be a real community project. Of course, there are strong discussions, but this is the, I would say, the added value of the community. We are going forward. It takes time. Unfortunately, bureaucracy doesn't look at projects if they are not-for-profit. Bureaucracy is as slow as for proprietary projects, so it takes almost 1 year to set up a foundation, because the law, you have to write an enormous amount of papers, and being all volunteers, of course, we do that in our spare time, and it takes an awful amount of time, unfortunately. But we are progressing. We are close to releasing. This morning we have released the first release candidate one of LibreOffice 3.4. Actually, last week we did release the last beta, telling that we were changing a little bit the release strategy, because the first betas of LibreOffice 3.4 have had significant problems. But these have been discussed in mailing lists, so we are not hiding anywhere. And any contributor is free to start working in the mailing list, start working with the hackers to make the suite better than it actually is. What we have done, we have built a vendor-neutral software. When you have a sponsor project, if the sponsor goes away, the project is at total risk. And this is what is happening now with OpenOffice. It's 1 month that Oracle doesn't give any hint about the future, and the entire project is at a risk. What we have built is a project that is vendor neutral. That means that if a single company that is sponsoring the project and is paying hackers for working on LibreOffice code goes away, the project is not going to die. The project may slow down a little bit, of course, because it's not easy to teach developers to work on such a large code. LibreOffice is over 10 million lines of codes. It's not easy for any, I'm not a developer, but it's easy to understand that it's not a trivial task to work on a 10 million line of code software. But once you have people that start, and once you have a number of core developers that are able to really, that know the software and are able to hack the code, then you are able to grow the community with new people. What has happened since September 28, the core developers that at the time were around 15 have started to get in new people, and now we have five people more in the core developer group, which is quite is 30% more. And some of them are independent people. We will announce in a few days the engineering steering committee. The engineering steering committee is based, of course, on Novell people, Red Hat people, Canonical people. But then you have independent guys that have been elected by developers in the engineering steering committee, because they've shown in just 8 months that they are able to build features. They started at the end of, actually, this is a French guy living in Texas that has started as committed the first easy hack on September 29, and is now working at developing features. Of course, he's a senior developer, he's someone with a lot of experience, but in 8 months, with the help of the core developers that were already working on the code, he has become independent in producing and progress for the software. So that's what is happening. This is a long process. It's not a process that you can say is finished in 6 months. It's probably a process going over for years and years. But the fact is that today we have around 120 ongoing contributors and 80 more that are committing patches every now and then. So at the end of the month, we will announce LibreOffice 3.4. We have made clear that as we use a time-based release process, this is not exactly like any other release process, any other software release process. So you have to be careful about the version that you are using, especially if you are deploying the software in a corporation. So if you have a large deployment, we strongly suggest to wait a little bit to deploy the software, just because we, being a community-based development project, we need the community to work on the code to make real-life test, not before we announce the product, but when the first releases are announced. So we have betas, we have release candidates, but we consider our 0.0 release, so the next LibreOffice 3.4, as the release for the enthusiasts, not for the conservative users. If we think at software announced by a large company based in Redmond, United States, they don't tell you so transparently what they think about releases, but you all know that if you deploy the first release of any of their software, it's exactly the same thing. And we are speaking about a $60 billion company with thousands of paid developers. So what are doing our developers? You have 20 core developers developing features, packaging the product, developing patches. We have around 40 regular contributors. When I say regular, these are people that commit at least a patch or a feature per week. So it's quite really regular. And then we have 60 that are committing probably every 2-3 weeks, once a month. And they are working on easy access code cleaning. Code cleaning is one of the fundamental strategies that we have implemented. OpenOffice source code was commented in German. You can because it was built out of Hamburg. And it was started to be built in the 80s, when probably no one thought as StarOffice as an international product. Today is an international product that by any means you cannot have an international software with the code commented in German. This doesn't make it international at all. So we have some German guys that are reading and translating the comments. So far they have translated more than 50,000 lines of code, of comment, and they have got rid of at least as many, because there were, of course, after so many years, there was many useless comments. Also, we clean the code from deprecated libraries. In the past, some libraries were deprecated, especially in the graphic area. In 20 years, you have a lot of progress in some areas. But the libraries were still there, so they made the code bloated and slower. And of course, when you clean the code, at the end, the code will be better, but the process is that in the meantime, you have a lot of dependencies. Some of these dependencies can be with the code that you have cleaned. So You may have some bugs that show up and are unexpected. This is something that all good hackers know. The problem is that LibreOffice is an end-user product, so you have many end-users that when they see a bug, they always suspect that the software is not good and stable. The software is good and stable. The problem is that we are going through a process for making it even better than it was in the past. This is the flow of contribution that you can see. Of course, if you ask me what it means, that shallow point, that's Christmas. And of course, everyone at Christmas was thinking about his own turkey or panettone, as we do in Milan, and not about code. Easy hacks is the area where I really challenge all of the hackers in this room to start having a look and start seeing if they can contribute something. There is an easy hack page. This is a list of the easy hacks, but there is, you can easily Google the easy hack page. It's probably 10 meters long, so it takes a day to scroll it. But there is something for everyone, not for me, but for every other people around. And we also have a completed hack page. This means that people are working well and they are moving the hacks to the completed hack page. But this is the area where people with technical skill can contribute, but there are many other things to do. Of course, the main one is development, because this is a software project, so you have a lot of things around development, like localization, like quality assurance, and so on. But also managing the mirrors and providing a packaged version and many, many other things. Our US community, which, by the way, was non-existing during the OpenOffice times, just because having a company in the United States made the U.S. community very difficult to manage, because the company wanted to make everything, and at the end the company was not doing anything, so the members of the community became frustrated. They have just produced a three-lingual DVD. It's a package, is easy to print and easy to burn, and is for conferences. Is in, of course, in English, is in French for French Canada and for some Caribbean islands, and Spanish for the Mexican and for Florida, Texas, and California, where Spanish speakers are many. So there is this is just an example. There is a lot to do on code, but there is a lot to do for any volunteer. QA, this is very important. There are nightly builds, and QA people have to install nightly builds and test nightly builds to see if they're working. Of course, sometimes this means that they are not working at all, but also knowing that something is not working at all helps the developers in understanding what they're done wrong. Then we have localization. LibreOffice is already available in around 100 languages. And if you think, yes, there was a community before that provided this almost the same software in almost the same number of languages. But this means that we have now localization servers in place, that we have all the infrastructure in place. People sometimes think that a software project that just comes out of the, I don't know, out of the heaven, or maybe being close to Mount Olympus, from Mount Olympus, without any contribution. No, there is a huge infrastructure behind. There are mailing lists, there are software for localizer. They have to commit their localization into a server, and then you need the server, and then you need someone that collates everything and makes the localized version. Then you have to look at graphics. We have very nice icons, and of course our graphic guys are the only one that have their own splash screen. All the other groups have not a splash screen, but I just want to show you the face of Paulo. Paulo is the guy, is a Brazilian guy. He started to work in the project in January, and is the author of our icons. He's a professional designer. He's a very nice guy, and this shows what a community can do. Then we have the web, and we have documentation. And at the end, if you are really desperate and don't find any other things to do, you can work with me at marketing. Although working with me, I'm an old guy, and is always, I don't know, a little bit fuzzy. But anyway, what are we doing? Yeah, what are we? It's the last. What are we doing? So we are working at the code, and we are working at the community. The ESC is going to be announced, and the community will be taking place as a legal entity in before the summertime. So I think that we really have our paper plane is really taking off, and. I'm finished for questions, so this is, I will give the presentation, is you can share it, it's not a problem. Any questions? Sorry, I was a little bit speedy up, but this is usually a 90-minute presentation, so to do it in 25 minutes, you needed to hurry a little bit up. But you have to ask at least one question. Okay. No, there is not a single problem. The question is if there was a single specific problem. No, there was not a single specific problem. There were many problems. I would say not problems. There were many opportunities that were not achieved. Because first, code cleaning. Some people think that we have started code cleaning just because we have nothing to do. No, we started code cleaning. Code cleaning was announced by Michael Bemmer at Lyon in 2006. I can show you the slide. There is a slide saying we have to do code cleaning. That was in 2006. That was never done until 2010. And it was, you know, yes, we are talking, and probably you get a presentation at next conference. But you cannot do code cleaning with PowerPoints. I can do a PowerPoint or an Impress or any other slide, but that's not code cleaning. Marketing. I was involved in marketing, and at the end of when I suggested, can we do this and that? No, because our marketing doesn't feel that this is a good idea, to the point that the percentage of open office in the state where Sun had the marketing ideas was less than 10%, and in Italy, where I was responsible for marketing, was 22%. So if you are on 22%, you've probably done something better than for less than 10. And Germany was another case, and France was another case. So there was not a single problem. And I would say that Sun and Oracle have done a wonderful job of developing the software. The problem is that they've done not a wonderful job in managing the community, and they've done a suboptimal job in marketing. I can judge marketing, and I can tell you that was a real human case marketing at Sun. I've never seen marketing done so badly, and Oracle has not done anything better than that. And you know, localization, some groups need more help than others. It's a question of, you know, the community is made by users, and users, of course, see their needs. A company has sometimes different needs, and especially companies that are have usually to do with the enterprise software, and Sun and Oracle are better versed at enterprise software than at user software, do not understand user software and user needs. And this was the real problem. The problem is that the community was asking things and the company was doing different things. Very good ones, but completely different sometimes. So there was not a single problem. There were missed opportunities. And we are trying. I'm not telling you that we are achieving all the missed opportunities. We are trying to pursue missed opportunities. And the business model is one of those, because if you don't sell the licenses, there's no meaning in continue to say, but we do more advertising. You don't sell licenses not because you're not doing advertising. You don't sell the licenses because the business model is wrong. Other questions? Sorry, it was a little bit long, but there is... Sorry. I'm here all day. Okay.